Philippine police deny they again raided the home of suspended Negros Oriental Congressman Arnolfo Teves Jr. Teves went live on Facebook Friday to accuse the police of planting evidence against him during the raid. But the police criminal investigation and detection group dismissed the lawmaker's allegation.
Ngayon lang, ni-raid na kaagad yung manukan sa bahay ko. Sana lang wala na namang tinanim. Malamang may itatanim naman yan para magmukha akong masama. Itong mga ganitong gawain, ano na talaga, panggigipit na at abuso na sa kapangyarihan.
Teves already faces illegal firearms charges after high-powered weapons were seized during a March raid in one of his properties. Teves is considered the main mastermind in the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Ruel Degamo. Beijing sends its top diplomat to Manila as both sides try to improve their strained relations. The three-day visit by Foreign Minister Chin Kang comes amid uproar over controversial remarks by Chinese envoy to Manila. We have more in this report.
A protest at the Chinese embassy hours before the arrival in Manila of China's Foreign Minister Chin Kang. The protesters demand the expulsion of Chinese Ambassador Wang Xilian over his perceived threat against overseas Filipino workers in Taiwan.
The message of this action is really to call for the recalling of their Ambassador Huang because of the problematic statements that he had issued, which had the effect of threatening or issuing a warning to the thousands of OFWs currently deployed in Taiwan. Gawing battleground no, ng inyong panibagong Cold War ang Pilipinas. Na ang gusto lang ng mga Pilipino ay magalang ang kanilang karapatan sa soberanya, makapaghanap buhay yung mga mangingisda namin at makapaghanap buhay yung mga OFW namin sa Taiwan na hindi nakakatanggap ng mga babala o mga pananakot.
Before he flew to Manila, Chin insisted that China has sovereign control over both sides of the Taiwan Strait.
Taiwan has been an inalienable part of China's territory since ancient times. Both sides of the Taiwan Strait belong to one China. This is the history of Taiwan and the current situation of Taiwan. Recently, there has been absurd rhetoric accusing China of challenging the rules-based international order and that it is trying to unilaterally upend the status quo in the Taiwan Strait by force or coercion, undermining the peace and stability in the Taiwan Strait. These statements run counter to basic international common sense and historical justice. The logic is absurd and the consequences are dangerous.
Beijing views democratically governed Taiwan as its own territory, a claim the government in Taipei strongly rejects. China recently held military exercises around the self-ruled island after Taiwan's president, Tsai Ing-wen, met with U.S. House of Representatives Speaker Kevin McCarthy in Los Angeles.
The Taiwan issue is at the core of China's key interests. For those who want to kick up a fuss about the One China principle, we are not going to be subtle here. Whoever takes action targeting China's sovereignty and security, we won't take a step back. Those who play with fire on the Taiwan issue will eventually get themselves burned.
Chin is undertaking an official visit to the Philippines from April 21 to 23 at the invitation of Foreign Affairs Secretary Enrique Manalo. The official visit continues the series of high-level interactions between the Philippines and China in 2023, following President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s state visit to China in early January.
Chinese Foreign Minister Chin Kang has met with Philippine Foreign Affairs Secretary Enrique Manalo this morning. We'll give you more details on what was discussed as they became available. Cagayan Governor Manuel Mamba remains hopeful the Marcos Jr. administration will change its mind and not grant U.S. forces access to two military facilities in his province. The governor asserts they were not consulted on the matter. He adds some mayors in his province did not sign off on the proposal. The naval base Camilo Osayas in Santa Ana and Lalo Airport in Cagayan are two of the four new sites under Manila and Washington's Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement.
I still maintain my opposition. And so I never had the really chance to talk about all of these things. Kaya sabi ko nga sa inyo, na nung kinausap nila ako, sabi nila, the president has decided and it's just a matter of announcing it. Anyway, so ang tingin ko, the president is getting wrong information from his from the people around him. But I was specifically telling this to Galvez. Ganun po yung pang ko dito.
Yeah.
Yung take ko dito.
Anyway,
nagkagasal, nagsusumamo pa rin na sana they reconsider their earlier decision. Because para sa akin po, sinabi na rin ng China through their ambassador that this is a provocation to the People's Republic of China. The EDCA sites, the new EDCA sites.
But in a statement released on Friday, Defense Department Officer in Charge Carlito Galvez said they welcome the expression of support from the mayors of Cagayan for the implementation of EDCA with the United States. He added 21 mayors have expressed their support and they expect this number to increase, with one municipality even intimating the possibility of donating a tract of land for the use of the armed forces of the Philippines. Calls mount to expel China's envoy to the Philippines following his supposed threat on Filipinos in Taiwan. To talk more about this and its implications, we are joined by De La Salle University International Studies Professor Renato De Castro. Good afternoon, Professor, and thank you so much for joining the program.
Good afternoon, Rica. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine. Professor, what about you? I hope you're good as well.
Well, I'm enjoying my weekend, but I'll give you my time.
Thank you so much for that.
Engage you in a discourse regarding this very important matter.
Yes, it's our pleasure having you here in the program. Professor, let's move now to what is really a very hot topic these past couple of months. Just recently, Ambassador Wang Shilian has made a statement that's seen by others as like a veiled threat to our OFWs in Taiwan. So there has been calls by different groups to expel the ambassador from the country for him to go back to China. I'd like to get your thoughts on this, please.
I think two reasons why we have to consider that suggestion of expelling or declaring the ambassador persona non grata. Number one, of course, is the fact that it's too severe. It will create, of course, a major breakdown in Philippine-China relations. Of course, we have some problems with China, but we have to understand China is our neighbor. And of course, the fact that China has the second largest economy in the world. The proper approach, of course, is to have the Assistant Secretary for the Asia-Pacific Bureau of the Department of Foreign Affairs to summon the ambassador for consultation. So that's a proper approach. Of course, the president already indicated that he will ask the ambassador to go to Malacanang again for consultation. And the other reason is, of course, the fact that if we think of expelling him or expel him, you know, declaring him persona non grata, this will be a case, of course, of shooting the messenger. Mm-hmm. We have to understand his message. It's, you know, he was never, of course, quoted out of context. He was telling us a matter of fact that sooner or later, of course, China will use force against Taiwan to effect, of course, the eventual unification, whether by force or, of course, through peaceful means. So in a way, he's telling us, your 200,000 OFW would sooner or later be find themselves in harm's way because China would use force against Taiwan. So this is a message that our government and our people should take seriously and start planning, of course, for possible contingency on how possibly we could delay this, cause China to have second thoughts, and of course, effect certain measures, no matter hard or what, to ensure at least we could effect at least a orderly evacuation of those 200,000 Filipinos working in Taiwan.
There actually has been a lot of statement from MECO and the president also inviting the Ambassador Wang Shilian to have an audience with him just so they'd be able to clear the air between the two sides. Now, you already mentioned earlier, Professor, that the OFWs in Taiwan will sooner or later find themselves in harm's way. What do you think the president should say to the kind ambassador when they would be able to finally meet?
Well, the president will... Okay.
Professor?
It's frozen.
Yeah, we're still getting you, Professor. So
I cannot hear you. Can you repeat it again?
Yeah.
It got frozen.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So
okay.
I was.
Can you repeat again?
Mm-hmm. All right. I mentioned that the president has invited the kind ambassador Wang Shilian to have an audience with him. What do you think they should be discussing, knowing that this is already out in the open?
Probably the president will ask him to further tell him about, you know, what's the message all about.
Mm-hmm.
That it is indeed that China is planning to take, you know, a major effort that will, of course, possibly affect, you know, lead to the either peaceful or, of course, a violent unification between mainland China and what we consider its renegade province, Taiwan.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And of course, also the fact that tell him, you know, try to be very subtle with your message. We don't know. Honestly, I cannot second guess what will be their agenda in Malacanang.
Mm-hmm. Diplomacy is a very delicate subject that that international
Hello.
Matters have to play. Now, Professor, some senators, other lawmakers are actually saying that Ambassador Wang Shilian is issuing such a strong statement.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you now.
Is this clearer now, Professor? Can you hear me well? Let's go back to where we left off earlier. Some lawmakers, particularly some senators, are saying that Ambassador Wang Shilian has been making strong statements on Philippine soil. Do you think he should start to curb back on things that he's going to be saying? Or is this just part of political gameplay?
Can you repeat it again, please?
Yes, if some lawmakers, Professor, are saying that Ambassador Wang Shilian are making strong statements on Philippine soil, do you think he should be holding back on his statements, or is this some part of political gameplay?
Well, that's part of what you call the wolf warrior diplomacy.
Mm-hmm.
The Chinese diplomats has to basically make some efforts to assert the country's interests. This is part of Chinese diplomatic style at the time that China now has the second largest economy, China field. So this is under perspective, of course, that they're facing Waxi.
Mm-hmm.
So the approach of Chinese diplomats to become very assertive regarding, you know, in terms of advancing their foreign policy. I still remember my good friend from the Department of Foreign Affairs, Assistant Secretary Ed De Vega, basically describing it, that's their job as diplomats.
Mm-hmm.
To assert their country's foreign policy, but of course, there's also an element of style. So at this point in time, the Chinese diplomats are under ordered to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and of course, from the Chinese Communist Party, to apply what is called wolf warrior diplomacy.
Mm-hmm.
So we are the receiving end of this warrior diplomacy.
Mm-hmm. I have been reading some reports of some international analysts saying almost the same thing that you're saying, Professor, that what China is doing now is more of like a dog that has more bark, but not that much of a bite. Is it the same thing?
I don't think so. China, mm-hmm. of course, would use its economic might to pull its weight around. And
mm-hmm.
of course, especially in the case of the Philippines and in other Southeast Asian countries, we see already in our maritime domain the People's Liberation Army's Navy operating, and of course, the Chinese Coast Guard. So this wolf warrior diplomacy is happening at the same time that China is applying gray zone operation against, of course, the Philippines and other countries in the region. So what we're basically seeing is, you know, China's growing assertiveness at the time that it feels that the correlation of forces are on their side.
Mm-hmm. So is this the time for the Philippines to finally decide which side we're going to be more friends with between the United States and China?
I still remember the statement of the foreign, the former National Security Advisor, my former professor, Dr. Carita Carlos, and when she was interviewed by ANC. And, you know, her statement captures the essence of what's happening right now. China has pushed the Philippines into the arms of the Americans. So China is simply not giving us any room to maneuver. It's playing a very uncompromising game, a zero-sum game, that pushes us, of course, into the arms of the Americans.
Mm-hmm. But then, of course, if this happens, we're going to be on the other end of the spectrum. We're going to be, in a way, viewed by China as an enemy.
Oh, there's no one to blame but China itself. China is its own enemy as it pursues a wolf warrior diplomacy and gray zone operation against, of course, a country that is, of course, at this point in time, has the capacity to play a very significant balancing role.
Let's move.
Our location is in the southern part of what they call the First Island Chain. Our country is big enough to host sizable number of American forward deployed forces. And of course, we are the receiving end of China's gray zone operation in the West Philippine Sea, South China Sea. So this is our situation right now.
It's something that we should, that the government, the Philippine government, should really be thinking about, because one way or another, we have to make a choice. Now, let's move now to the foreign minister of China, actually already here for a three-day visit. They're going to be having talks on agreements made during the bilateral talks between two presidents of our countries. What are you expecting, Professor, would be the outcome of this?
Well, I think that he will also raise the same point raised by the current ambassador. And, of course, something that the Chinese raised during the bilateral consultation. Why are we allowing greater strategic footprint for American forces by increasing the IRCA site? Probably asking, you know, what's the story behind the very strong statement issued in Washington during the 2+2 meeting, probably also talking about the aspects of Balikatan. And, of course, again, giving us that warning. And interestingly, you know, this new foreign minister is taking a more hardline approach than his predecessor, Foreign Minister Wang Yi. So we expect more of this wolf warrior diplomacy from him.
Of course, when we talk about this, what should the president be firm about now? We have a lot of issues regarding China.
Well, it's have to be, steady regarding his position. The goal, as he stated, is friends to all, enemies to none. But of course, we are faced by greater Chinese assertiveness. China is pushing us into the arms of the Americans. So we really have to consider, in a way, take note of what's happening. And of course, on the part, the president will have to play a very decisive, pivotal role in terms of how he will steer our foreign policy in the middle of the growing tension between China and the United States.
Okay, let's move now to regional security, Professor. How do you think we should go about this? Some experts are saying that we should be starting a cooperative or a coalition with other nations, other Southeast Asian nations, to take a stand against China.
No, I think that's basic. Is we strengthen our society by, of course, unifying behind the president. And of course, looking forward to the development of a credible defense capability by modernizing and investing more in the armed forces of the Philippines, a program to develop a credible defense capability. So we start with something we could do here at home. And of course, coming out with a national security strategy that will guide Filipino, inform the Filipino people what are the dangers we face in the international environment, and basically set into motion a sort of efforts on the part of, our decision makers that we have to be, in terms of response, we have to have a direction.
All right, last.
Because the situation out there is, of course, as, quoting the statement, the report of the Chinese, the 20th Congress of the Chinese Communist Party, even for us, the waters out there are stormy.
All right. Last question, Professor, before I let you go. Let's rate the relationship of our two countries, our diplomacy with China. How satisfied are you with the president's handling of this?
I think I'm very much satisfied with what he did. He finally, of course, realized early on in his term, unlike the previous administration, it took the previous administration probably 4 years to realize that China is playing an uncompromising zero-sum approach when it comes, of course, to the West Philippine Sea, South China Sea issue, and even, of course, in the case of the Taiwan issue. So China is simply boxing us in. We have no choice but to stand on our ground.
All right. So I've had a good time with that. I will let you go. I've had a good time talking with you, Professor. I hope I'd be able to speak with you again one more day.
As I say, I'm at your beck and call.
Thank you. Have a happy weekend ahead, Professor. You have a good
day. Okay, bye.
Thank you.
Have a great-
That was De La Salle University International Studies Professor Renato De Castro joining us.